So to, is there a possibility to dim this in those slides?
Yes. Yeah.
So, good morning, everybody. So we will spend the day today concerning the interacting boson model. So there will be two lectures in the morning, and then there will be exercises in the afternoon. The lectures will be concentrated mainly on analytic results, how to solve problems analytically, while the exercises will be numerically. So to see that these analytic results are valid by doing a numerical calculation. So my lectures of today and also on Friday are concerning the interacting boson and the interacting boson fermion model. And I will start with a rather long prologue today, why symmetries are important. Because I feel that you should get this basis in order to understand the rest of the lectures. And then in part one, we will study dynamical symmetries and how we can apply them to even nuclei. So having an even number of protons and an even number of neutrons. In the second part, on Friday, we will see how these ideas can be applied to odd A and odd nuclei. That means with an odd number of neutrons or protons or both. For that, we will use the concept of Bose-Fermi symmetries and also of supersymmetries, which are invented in particle physics but have also applications in nuclear physics. Now, in the lectures, emphasis will be laid on the experimental test of the symmetry concept. In this sense, can we see in experimental data effects of these symmetries. So the lectures are based on a book which I wrote with Piet and Alejandro Frank, which probably you can download in your university because it's a Springer book. At least at the University of Cologne, you can download the complete book for free. And so if you would like to have the reference, then you have to use this link, which I leave you some time to write it down if you want, and you can try then to get the complete ebook as a download. Secondly, I would like to mention two other books. The first one is by Iacchiello and Arima. It's called The Interacting Boson Model, and it concerns the lectures of today, except that the neutron-proton version of the interacting boson model will be treated tomorrow by Norbert Pietralla. The second one is again a book of Piet and Franco Iacchiello, and it's called The Interacting Boson Fermion Model, and it deals with the lectures I will give on Friday. So if you want to take a look during the coffee break, the books are here, and so you can also take the coordinates of the books. So, why symmetries are important? Now, let's start with classical physics. In classical physics, if you have a closed system, and that's denoted by this square, and in this closed system, that's no interactions with the environment, you want to formulate physical laws. Then you would like to formulate them such that if you make a just displacement in space of this closed system and the laws, then you would like that the laws don't change. It would be very complicated if every place you have to redefine physical laws again. And because of this property, we have the conservation of momentum, P. At the same time, we would like that the physical laws, which are valid now, were also valid at the beginning of the universe, or are valid in 1 billion years after we are living here. So it means that we would like to have an invariance over time displacement. This leads to the conservation of energy, A. And finally, if you have the physical system and you let it rotate in space, then you would like that the physical laws don't change. This leads to the conservation of angular momentum, L. And if you think about your physics course, classical mechanics and all classical physics, then the conservation of momentum, the conservation of energy, and the conservation of angular momentum are in some sense the basis in order to make the description of our material world. So this shows in classical physics that symmetries are very important. It facilitates our description of the universe. Now, the question is, are there more constants of motion like energy, momentum, angular momentum? And we go over to quantum mechanics, and the first real success of quantum mechanics was Niels Bohr's description of the hydrogen atom in 1913. Now, if you look at the solution of Bohr's description, which, by the way, is completely wrong, but nevertheless the answers were right and were in agreement with experimental facts, then if you look at this description of the hydrogen atom, then in essence you have a very simple formula. It says the energy of a state is given by the main quantum number n, the angular momentum L and its projection m, and this energy is equal to a physical constant, the Rydberg constant, divided by the main quantum number squared. So that's what Niels Bohr found out, and that agreed very well with experiments. Now let's consider a little bit more. What does this say? N is also a conserved quantity, or a constant of motion, which is independent of the value of this constant. Yeah? So you can have another value for this constant, you will have the same n. Wave functions do not depend on the value of this constant. So the wave functions are independent of this proportionality value. And finally, n gives us which values of L we can have, and L in turn gives us which values of m we can have. So it means we have kind of what is called quantum numbers, which are n, L, and m, and so there are relations between the upper quantum number, which is the main quantum number n, and L, and then between L and m. Now, only 20 years later, the brilliant Russian physicist Vladimir Fock, which by the way is also the inventor of the second quantization, in 1934 found out that the equations of the hydrogen atom are invariant under orthogonal rotations in four dimensions. O4, like O3, is for orthogonal rotations in three dimensions, and they exhibit a dynamical symmetry. And that we will study in a first instance, and that will be very important for the rest of the course, a dynamical symmetry. Now, symmetries are associated with groups, and so the relation between Lie groups and quantum mechanics is quite important, and so we want to study this a little bit more. What is a Lie group? If I do a rotation, yeah, then I can do an infinite number of different rotations. Yeah? And this is described by Lie groups because these are what is called continuous groups. It means you can do a continuous movement of rotations with an infinite number of elements. So I have infinite number of rotations I can make. And So we start with this example, which is common to us, rotations in three dimensions, which form the Lie group SO3. Now, associated to this infinite number of rotations, there is an algebra. And the algebra has a limited number of elements. So let's illustrate this. So associated to the Lie group is a Lie algebra with a limited number of called generators, JK, that generate the rotation alpha via exponentiation. Let's take as a first example rotations in two dimensions. Yeah, so I have here x, y, z, and then I can turn the z-axis, changing the x and the y-axis, and do this rotation over an angle alpha. Now, in order to generate such a rotation, we can apply the exponentiation of the Lz operator, so the z component of the angular momentum. So Lz explicit in quantum mechanics is given here as minus e hash bar x d di minus epsilon d dx. And so if I do this rotation, I can generate any two-dimensional rotation by just changing the angle alpha and applying this generator. So we conclude that if you have a rotation in two dimensions, there is only one generator in the algebra, which is the Lz operator. So L2, I can make an infinite number of rotations in two dimensions, which forms the group. The algebra itself has only one element, one generator, Lz. And now Piet probably has illustrated in his course, if you do now rotations in three dimensions, then you have to do a rotation around the z-axis, a rotation around the x-axis, and a rotation around the y-axis. And you can generate any rotation in three dimensions by applying Lx, Ly, and Lz, the three components of the angular momentum operator. Or if you write it as a scalar product, then you have here, because the rotations have also an x component, an y component, and a z component, you have the scalar product between alpha defining the angle of the rotation and the angular momentum. So we conclude that while for SO2 we had only one generator, for SO3 rotations in three dimensions we need three generators of the group of the algebra, and they are the x, y, and z component of the angular momentum. Now, generally, of course, you would like to have a mathematical definition, and this was done by Sophus Lie. A set of generators define a Lie algebra if they close under commutation. That means if you take two generators, you take the commutator, you can write it as a linear set of the other generators. So this is what is denoted here. Is there a laser pointer in this thing? Yeah. So this is what is denoted here. If I take the commutator of two generators, then I can write it as a linear combination of the other generators. And these constants are called the structure constants, or the Lie structure constants. So that's an important property. And on the other hand, they have to fulfill the Jacobi identity, which is again a combination of commutators. So we have the commutator of GK with the commutator of the other two, and then you have a cyclic, you see M moves here to the first place, and then L moves here to the first place in the third one, and this has to be zero. So as an example you know very well, is the angular momentum operators, which are the generators of the SO3 algebra. So if you take the commutator of Lx and Ly, then you get something which is Lz. Ly, Lz, then you get Lx, Lz, Lx, then you get something which is proportional, linear to Ly. You have seen also in quantum mechanics that there are more examples. These are the orbital angular momentum operators, but also the spin angular momentum operators. They fulfill the same commutation rules. And because spin operators and orbital operators commute, you can now sum the orbital angular momentum and the spin angular momentum to get the total angular momentum, and again, you get the same commutation rules. So these are three examples of this angular momentum, spin angular momentum, and total angular momentum operators. Now, the next thing I would like to introduce are Casimir operators. They were invented by Hendrik Casimir, who quit science to become one of the directors of Philips in industry, which made Pauli very mad. He always called him Herr Director. So Casimir found out that for any Lie algebra, there are operators which are constructed out of the generators. This is important. So the operators are constructed out of the generators of the algebra, and which have the property that they commute with all generators. So the commutator of this operator constructed out of this GKs is equal to zero. And the operators, these Casimir operators, can be of first order, it means a linear combination, of second order, which means a quadratic, of third order, which is a cubic combination of generators. Now, let's start first with rotations in two dimensions. There is one generator, which is Lz. And of course, trivially, Lz commutes with itself. Yeah? Lz, commutator with Lz, is zero. So it means the Casimir operator of SO2 is Lz, as a linear Casimir operator. So we find that we have Lz as a Casimir operator of SO2. In SO3, it is the length of the angular momentum operator, so L square. So if you do a rotation, L square doesn't change its value. And in fact, you can prove that L square, commutator with Lx, Ly, and Lz is equal to zero. So this is then the Casimir operator. It's a Casimir operator of second order of the group SO3. There is no Casimir operator of first order for the group SO3. And so we conclude that L square is this Casimir operator. For SO2, which is the algebra associated with spin, it's S square. So the length of the spin angular momentum. And also here you can prove that S square with Sx, Xy, and Sz is commutator is equal to zero. And so we conclude that the Casimir operator of SO2 is the S squared operator. And so for any Lie group, you can find this kind of Casimir operators. Yeah? The last line?
Yeah. First line can be constructed out of the generator.
Yeah, the Casimir operator has to be constructed out of the generators. For instance, if you have L square, then it's Lx square plus Ly square plus Lz square. Yeah? So the Casimir operator, it cannot be, you could take any scalar, yeah? That would commute with all generators, but that has no sense. It has to be constructed out of the generators itself.
So it seems there are many Casimir operators.
Yes, there are several. Yeah, yeah. But we will generally restrict to Casimir operators up to the second order. Yeah? Only two body interactions, so to say. Yeah? But there are, this is a question of mathematics. Many of the things here are questions of mathematics. Yeah? And they are solved for once and forever. So there are general procedures how to construct the Casimir operators. Yeah?
In SO2,
yeah?
LZ include...
There's only one generator, LZ. So if you have to make a Casimir operator, it has to include LZ. And it's trivial that LZ commutes with itself. Yes. Yeah? And so it turns out that this is the Casimir operator. Now, in order to make the connection with things you know, if you, we will come to that, but if you know, if you apply LZ to a wave function, you will get M, magnetic projection. And if you apply L squared to a wave function, you will get L, L plus 1. So these are then eigenvalues, and they are constants. We will see why soon. S squared is, again,
no,
a Casimir.
I just want to know if Sx is always a Casimir operator, Sx.
Nah, no, because if we return, then we see that Sx with S epsilon gives Sz. It doesn't give S zero.
But if Sx we just commute with Sx again, that is the case for Lz.
No, you see, non. While we could have the linear one for LZ in SO2, because there's only one generator, in SO3 there are no linear possibilities, because always the commutator is not equal to zero. It always gives one of the other generators. It's only the length of the angular momentum or the length of the spin angular momentum which is conserved. So I cannot, unfortunately, then you have to come to the University of Köln and follow my course in winter semester, then I can prove everything in detail, but there is no time at the moment. Yeah? So the course starts 7th of October. Fazil will probably attend it. So these are the special operators, but now I would like to go to another point. This is, it's a simplified picture. But I just want you to grasp the idea. Don't go in detail. Mathematically, it's not all completely correct. But in order to get an idea why symmetries are important, we have to make some ideas about Hilbert spaces and unitary transformations. So to introduce the approach, and I will also use the an S and D boson system, which is the interacting boson model basis. So consider that we have N S and D boson and a wave function. So we can now, in second quantization, we can work on the vacuum, which is here, and then we have the creation operators of D boson with a magnetic quantum number plus 2, plus 1, 0, minus 1, and minus 2, and of course an S boson is an L equal 0, D is L equal 2, and so it has only a projection 0. Now, if we make our wave function out of these creation operators, then we have NS times the S boson creation, ND, and so on. And we need some normalization factor. Now we can consider the wave function to be a vector in a six-dimensional space. So the space is spanned by these different magnetic substates of the boson operators. Yeah? And this six-dimensional complex space we call the space spanned by S and D bosons. So this means we can write this six-dimensional vector, and we can put here how many S bosons, D minus 2, and so on we have. Now, suppose we change the basis to another one, which, of course, we can always do. Then we have here our original vector, six-dimensional. We have a matrix, which is a 6x6 matrix. And then we have now our changed number because of the changed basis. Now, here there are 36 matrix elements. 36 matrix elements in this matrix. Now, for wave functions, we impose that the norm should be a constant. Yeah? So the norm of this vector is then this and the transposed and the product of both. Yeah? So if you write it explicitly, then you have here the annihilation operators, and here you have the creation operators, and you have this normalization factor. But that should happen also if we do a change of basis. So this imposes on the matrix of the change of basis this big 36 element 6x6 matrix, which I denote by A, that the transposed product with the matrix itself should be the identity. Yeah? If this is valued, then I can here use A, A times the new basis and the new norm that makes this matrix out. And so if you do it explicitly, it means that the sum over J of complex conjugate matrix element AGI multiplying with the normal AGK has to be equal to delta EK for every E and K going from 1 to N. So now the N square conditions which result from this relation, yeah, N squared conditions, because we have E and K can be 1 to N, and we have, these were complex matrix elements, so we have 2n squared real parameters in our matrix. One real parameter describing the real part, and one real parameter multiplied with I describing the complex part of our matrix. So we get in total n squared three parameters. Yeah? So we have 2n squared real parameters. We have n squared conditions because of this property that the norm should be conserved. And so the set of n times n matrices fulfilling the conditions forms a realization of the unitary group un. In our case, n is equal to 6, u6. And more specific, the group un is called the n squared parameter Lie group, or the n squared order Lie group. In the case of our S and D boson space, the matrices form the group U6. We can impose one more condition, that the determinant of A has to be equal to 1, and then one speaks about this special unitary group, and this is denoted with SUN. And of course, one more condition makes it an n square minus 1 order Lie group. Now, we can continue. And we have our unitary matrices, so the matrices which have this property. Now we can look for subsets of these matrices which have other properties. And one important subset is, suppose we now do not mix in our basis transformation S and D bosons. So we make matrices which have here zeros and here zeros, such that the number of S bosons is conserved and the number of D bosons is also conserved. But the D bosons can transform between the magnetic substates. Now, instead of having now 36 complex numbers, we now have here one, and here we have 25. Yeah? So it's clear that this class of matrices forms a subset of the other class of matrices. And this, in group theoretical language, makes that this class of matrices is a subgroup of the original class of matrices. And because we have 5 times 5, in fact, the subgroup for the D bosons among themselves is U5. Here we had U6 because we had D and S boson, L equal 2 and L equals 0. And now here we have separately L equals 0 and L equal 2. Finally, we can now continue and make other subclasses of matrices. Now here we had complex numbers. Yeah? These matrix elements can have complex values. Now if we impose that we only take those matrices which have real numbers, that's very clearly a subset of the original matrices which has complex numbers. Now our condition here, Ji complex conjugate, Jk, because the complex conjugate is equal for a real number to the real number itself, it becomes now Rji, Jk is equal to delta Ik. Now because of this symmetry property, because now I can change Ji and Ejk like that, it's the same thing. It was not the same thing here because we had a complex conjugate. Yeah? But now it becomes the same thing. And that means that the number of conditions due to this request that the numbers are real is different. So we can take the diagonal elements, jj, jj. These are n of them. And then we have n times n minus 1 divided by 2 because of the symmetry property conditions for the off-diagonal elements. And now we see we have a different number of conditions equal to that on our n squared parameters, not anymore 2n squared, because the numbers have to be real. There are only n squared parameters. And if you do the calculation, very simple calculation, you find out that these matrices which have this condition, they form an n times n minus 1 divided by 2 order Lie group. And those are denoted by the symbol ON or SON. And so we find that if we started from the transformation matrices for S and D bosons, then we had a unitary in six-dimension group. We had a subgroup, which is U5. We can just leave this out here. And then we find that there is also a subset of matrices which are fulfilling the SO5 symmetry. It turns out that we can continue this and find out that we end up with an SO3 symmetry. But now, why are symmetries so important in quantum mechanics? Now, suppose we have a Hamiltonian which commutes with generators of a group G. Yeah? It means that this Hamiltonian is constructed out of Casimir operators. So if the Hamiltonian commutes with the generators, it is said to have the Lie algebra G, or to be invariant under this Lie algebra G. Now, what does it mean? It means that if I take any generator from this algebra and I have a solution, this is the Hamiltonian, I have a solution with an eigenvalue of the Hamiltonian, and I now operate with the generator GK on this solution, then because of the commutation rules, I can change the sequence. Because this was a solution of this Hamiltonian, it has an energy eigenvalue and the wave function again. And now GK is working on a scalar, so it means I can again change the sequence of the energy. Energy is a scalar, and so I obtain here then GK on gamma. And so if we now look at the total, then we see if I have a gamma solution with an energy A, then for all generators I can construct other solutions having the same energy. So all these states are degenerate, all have the same energy. And I can construct as many as I have generators. But that means that I can classify the energy as belonging to a certain quantum number, gamma, and I can classify the degenerate states by another quantum number, gamma, small, by just to classify these different states. And if I work on such wave functions, then the generators can only change the value of small gamma, but they cannot change the value of big gamma, because big gamma is classifying the energy. So it means they can not get out of this big gamma, they just can change the small gamma. Now that's very important, will become important afterwards. In the language of group, I will come to that. As I said, my prologue is rather long. Now, suppose now that we can find or construct by linear combinations a subset of generators. So from the original set of generators, GK, we can now select a subset of them belonging to this original set, and they also fulfill the Lie algebra condition. So they commute among themselves, or one says they close under commutation. Now, they are then the generators of a Lie subalgebra G prime, being part of the larger algebra G. And associated with that, there is a subgroup of transformations which has the same G prime definition. Remember, generators, finite number, generate an infinite number of rotations in an abstract space of any dimension. Now, as I said, for every Lie algebra, there are Casimir operators. Now, we can construct now the Casimir operators of a certain order, n prime of this sub-algebra. And it has the property that it commutes with all generators of the sub-algebra. However, it doesn't commute with all generators of the original algebra. The Casimir operator, if I apply it and I take one of the generators of the original algebra, which is not a part of the subalgebra, there is no guarantee that it commutes. However, the important point is all operators of the subalgebra do commute with the Casimir operator of the original algebra. So that's an important point. Consider now that we have an Hamiltonian, which is the Casimir operator of the original algebra, with which all operators commute, and the Casimir operator of the subalgebra, with which only a part of the original generators commute. Then we have that the Hamiltonian commutes with all generators of the subalgebra, and that means that where we had gamma and small gamma, now we can have even an additional quantum number, because if I apply this to an eigenstate, I will get a degenerate eigenstate having the same energy, but only for part of the subalgebra. So now I have three quantum numbers, alpha, beta, gamma. And one has that the Hamiltonian working on alpha, beta, gamma state being A, the Casimir operator, which does not allow to change alpha, so which defines the energy as a function of alpha, and we have a Casimir operator of this subgroup which cannot change beta. And so we now obtain that the analytic solution of such a Hamiltonian is A times the energy as a function of alpha, alpha, beta, gamma, plus B, the energy as a function of beta, of alpha, beta, gamma. The addition of the Casimir operator of the subgroup cannot break the original symmetry. That's the essential point. The original alpha quantum number is conserved. Yeah.
Small gamma.
Yeah.
Quantum number associated with
the subalgebra. The degeneracy of the subalgebra. Because this holds for a subset. Yeah? So it means, let's say I have 36 generators in the beginning, and I go to a subset of 25. Then if I have one solution with an energy, if I apply 25 times this generator on this solution, I will always get another solution with the same energy. So I will get a 25 degenerate state. And so in order to classify that, the small gamma from before, which is now replaced by the beta, yeah, by the beta, we have an additional label describing the degeneracy of the subalgebra. So before I had two quantum numbers, one describing the energy, one describing the degeneracy. Now I have three, one describing the original energy, one describing the energy due to the subalgebra, and one describing the final degeneracy, alpha, beta, gamma. The energies depends on alpha, on beta, and the degeneracy is classified by gamma. Think of, I will come to a concrete example. Yep.
I have a question. Before you said that actually the Hamiltonian has to build up with just the Casimir operator of the total algebra.
Yeah.
And now you are adding it,
yeah,
the sub
with the Casimir operator of the subalgebra. Yeah. Yes, it can be. We will see. I will come to a very common example, which you know from Pete's lectures. So, now let's get it a little bit more complicated, but important.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Could you go back?
Yeah. Yeah.
It means you are considering more small treasure.
Yes. So maybe I should, before, can I just jump a couple of transparencies to get you a concrete example, and then I come back to the more complicated thing of irreducible. So let's go just forward a moment in order to make it concrete. Angular momentum, that you know. So the Hamiltonian, we have the Hamiltonian, which the Schrödinger equation, time independent. And then we have this Lie algebra of angular momentum. So we have L plus, L minus, LZ, or LX, LY, LZ. Now the Casimir operator we saw of O3 is L square. Yeah? L square commutes and always is equal to zero. Now, if we have a Hamiltonian, the first of the supergroup, the higher group, we can say the Hamiltonian is A times L square, and we know that the energies are then L, L plus 1 as a function of L. Yeah? And now what we do by having the subgroup, now the subgroup is O2, which is a subgroup of O3, and the Casimir operator we saw is LZ. Yeah? So now I make a Hamiltonian of the Casimir operator of the higher group, O3, and the Casimir operator of the lower group. Now, if you take L square and A L square and B LZ, then the solution is A L L plus 1 plus B M. And what you do by introducing this term, you just have, for instance, a magnetic field. And so the M degeneracy, which you had in the original symmetry, so we had 2L plus 1 different values of L, M here degenerate. Now, by applying a magnetic field, this degeneracy is split off, and so we get here the separate magnetic substates. But we do not break the quantum number L. That's an important point. L is conserved. Although now states are not anymore degeneracy, we still can classify the states by L and M, because SO3 has SO2 as a subalgebra or subgroup. Okay, let's return to some more complicated things, which you in some sense also know, but never have seen it in this kind of mathematical description. Irreducible representations. They are extremely important because they make it possible to actually do calculations. Without this property, it would not be possible to do calculations because the matrices would be so gigantic that you cannot diagonalize them. Now, since for every generator there is this matrix AK which describes these transformations, they form a matrix representation of the algebra. Let me just return to review what we mean by these matrices here. So if GK is working on a state gamma and small gamma, then it can only produce other small gammas, but it cannot change the big gamma. Yeah? So that's the matrix representation. Now, if we have these matrices, we can apply unitary transformations on them. And the important thing is that we can make a block structure of the big matrix, in which we have many zeros. These are zero blocks, this can be 4 by 4 or bigger and so on. And then we have certain parts which we cannot transform in a block structure anymore. If we take the example of angular momentum, this was also discussed yesterday by Mark, we have this kind of cross product of a J value and a J prime value. Then it turns out that we can transform this in such a way that we have now values of J minus J prime, J minus J prime plus 1, up to J plus J prime. This is the vector coupling. Yeah? Vector coupling. And we cannot transform away inside these blocks. Now, but on the other hand, all the rest of these matrices are zeros. And these values, J minus J2 up to J plus J2, form what is called an irreducible representation. Now, what is important here is that there are rules. These are these Clebsch-Gordan coefficients mentioned yesterday, or 3J symbols. If I have J and J prime as irreducible representations of SO3, then I have rules how to couple them to form new irreducible representations of SO3. And these new irreducible representations are just these combinations. If I have 2 and 2, I can go to J 0 and up to 4. Yeah? So important is these are irreducible representations and these are irreducible representations. Again, trust mathematics. They have done everything. I have rules how to define all this irreducible representation. To explain that would take a semester course, and I cannot do that. Now, you know these transformation coefficients as the Clebsch-Gordan coefficients from your basic quantum mechanics rule. I hope it's still given, Eclipse Gordon, because solid-state physicists don't like that so much. Now, there are rules, I said, there are rules to define how to combine irreducible representations. They have been invented by mathematicians and physicists, Wigner and others. So if you have now these quantum numbers, which I called alpha, beta, gamma, they label the irreducible representations. And generally, this is done by a partition. So a general group can be characterized by a set of L integer numbers called a partition, such that the first one is higher than the second one, and the third one, and finally up to L. And the sum is equal to the number of particles. This can be fermions, this can be bosons. So L is called the rank of the group, and you can picturally present them by a Jung tableau. So for instance, if I have 10, 6, and 0, then I have 10 boxes here, and I have 6 boxes here. Interesting is that this representation has some properties. If you have bosons, then you can only have one row, identical bosons, because these are symmetrized, and following the generalized Pauli principle, for bosons you need a symmetrized wave function, while the columns, like here, are anti-symmetrized. So it means if you have 5 halves of fermions, then if you have 4 of them, you cannot have 2 fermions with the same symmetrized quantum number, so they have to be anti-symmetrized. So it means you can only have one box here, one box here, one box here, one box here. And now I would like to mention something very important that you have to realize. If I have 5 halves fermions, I have 6 substates. If I have S and D bosons, I have 6 substates. Both are described by a unitary transformation in 6 dimensions. Yeah? So it's not so that SU6 is associated with S and D bosons. No. SU6 can be realized using fermionic generators and can be associated with J5 halve fermions as well. So there are different realizations of the groups. Now, here I list the order and the ranks of the different groups in order to be complete. Now, as I said, mathematicians have solved all the mathematical problems, and so here you have the description of, for any group UN, how the Casimir operators are constructed is not given here, but the eigenvalues of the Casimir operators are given here as the function of how many quantum numbers you need to label, which depends on the rank of the group. And so you have general prescriptions for all groups that are available. Now, I come to the important thing we started with. What is a dynamical symmetry? First of all, what is dynamics? Dynamics is described by the Hamiltonian. Yeah? The dynamics of a system, quantum mechanical system, is described by the Hamiltonian. Symmetries, we have seen, is associated with Lie algebras and has to do with this commuting set of generators, which form then the Lie algebra G. Now, Hamiltonians are made out of operators. Generators are operators of the Lie algebra. So if we now combine both, so we know that we have to construct a Hamiltonian out of the generators, of operators, and if we now take these operators to be the generators of a Lie algebra, then we know that there exist special generators like Casimir operators, which commute with all generators. And now, if we have a dynamical symmetry, we will now combine the dynamics of a quantum mechanical system with the symmetries by constructing the Hamiltonian out of generators, especially out of Casimir operators, which are constructed out of generators of a certain Lie algebra. And if we do that, then we saw before that we can now construct degenerate wave functions by just applying on a known wave function with a certain value of the energy, these upper generators on this known wave function, constructing new wave functions, and they all have the same energy. They are degenerate. And if we now can construct a chain of subalgebras or subgroups by considering from the original set of generators a subset and a subset of the subset and a subset of the subset of the subset, then we can construct a Hamiltonian which has coefficients, Casimir operators of these subalgebras, and then we have a solution which has now quantum numbers and which has an analytic expression for the energies of these Casimir operators of the subgroups. So this is what I showed before in the case of angular momentum, where it's natural to you to do that. Now, a last important point is the Wigner-Eckardt theorem, which we discussed also partially yesterday. Now, often you have to calculate matrix elements between different wave functions. So wave functions, let's take just O3 and O2. They are classified by angular momentum J and the projection M. Now, if this operator also, and that's important, also has a good angular momentum small j and a good projection small m, then one can apply the Wigner-Eckardt theorem. And what is the Wigner-Eckardt theorem telling you? There is a kind of four factor here, which is a geometrical factor, which has to do with how the values of m are contained in the values of j. And there is a matrix element which is independent of this. It's called a reduced matrix element, and it only depends on the quantum number of the higher group, j, small g, and j prime. These values, again, are tabulated by physicists and mathematical physicists and so on. And so they hold for every combination of those. So it means that if I have here a five state, L equal 5 and an L equal 4. Then I have here 9 and here I have 11. So I have 99 matrix elements. It turns out there's only one which is essential, the reduced one. These are tabulated coefficients. So instead of having to calculate 99, I also have here different values of M. So let's say that J is 1. Then I have 99 times 3 elements, which I should calculate. Here, only have to calculate 1. So it's an enormous reduction of what you have to do. Moreover, what I mentioned yesterday to Mark, most of these coefficients are 0. Because you have rules, these are irreducible representations of O3, these are irreducible representations of O2. And there are rules. You know that M has to be from minus J to plus J, and there is a change of 1 between every M value. On the other hand, you have rules in this direction, that the sum of the magnetic projections has to be equal to the final magnetic projection. So you have kind of multiplication rules on the O2 level. You have multiplication rules on the O3 level. You need a vector coupling. You cannot couple a 2 with a 1 to a 5. It doesn't work. So it means there are a lot of funny rules in these coefficients, making that most of them are 0. And again, 3 times 99 matrix elements reduced to 1. So that's why symmetries are so important. Yes?
Fazil?
This, I will come to that. That's the next thing. This you know from quantum mechanics, advanced quantum mechanics, I hope. Yeah. You learned about the Wigner-Eckart theorem. Yeah. Now, we want to go a little bit further. Because this holds for all subalgebras. Not only for SO3 and SO2, but concerning your question, it also holds for U6 to U5. So that's the generalized Wigner-Eckart theorem. So if I have a group, general, and a subgroup, and I have this IREPS classified by these quantum numbers gamma and gamma, then if I can define a tensorial operator, T, to have a certain tensorial character gamma and gamma under these two groups, then the following holds, and that's the generalized Wigner-Eckart theorem. So I can write all these matrix elements as a function of a geometrical factor given by group theory and a reduced matrix element, like in the Wigner-Eckart theorem. This factor is called an isoscalar factor, and this is a reduced matrix element. And again, important is that in these isoscalar factors, most of them are zero, because I have now also rules combining this irreducible representation with this one will only yield certain irreducible representations, and a kind of reduction rule, which irreducible representation of the lower group is contained in the irreducible representation of the higher group. So that's a very important thing. So the Wigner-Eckart theorem does not only hold for angular momentum, but it holds on a much higher level. Yes.
Yeah, I was just wondering what exactly isoscalar meant in a generalized group theory context.
Isoscalar, you have also isospin, yeah, and there the term isoscalar is also used.
Right. So,
maybe Pete can answer this.
I think there is no relation with isospin.
Yeah. No. No, it's a general. Yeah. Now, if you have now a chain, of subgroups, then you can first apply to the higher group. So now you have here many quantum numbers, and then you do it first to the higher, and then you have this factor, and then you continue. Now you reduce the reduced matrix element, and then you have three lines or four lines, and then of course for every subgroups there are separate factors. That's what you mean. Eh?
Yes.
So you can factorize it. Yeah, and probably that's the reason why it's called isoscalar factor. But it's generalized Clebsch-Gordan coefficient. You can also, or 3J. Or so you can continue with this. OK, now we come to part one after this rather long introduction.
Yeah.
I know. I just watched my clock. So the interacting Bose model. We will discuss even nuclei. That means an even number of protons and an even number of neutrons. Yeah, it's 1/4 of all nuclei. And so generally, we have A nucleons. A can be 168 or something like that. And that's much too complicated to do in ab initio. Mark Caprio will talk about that on Thursday. You can go up to 12 nucleons or something like that, but not up to 150 or something. So that means that we have to do some truncations, and one of the important truncations is the existence of shell structures. So we can see that the protons and the neutrons they form closed shell with large gaps. And so we can, instead of starting with all these fermions, which is a huge number of nucleons, we can now go over to valence nucleons. So it means if you have a closed shell, then everything couples to zero. Yeah, all the magnetic substates are present, filled, so it all couples to zero. And so we can consider the closed shell, especially of a double magic nucleus, as being inert. Yeah, so it doesn't contribute to the collective excitations at low energy. So this is a huge truncation of our model space. Instead of having 150, we now have to consider 20 nucleons, for instance. So that's the first reduction, but it's not sufficient in medium-heavy and heavy nuclei. There are still too many of them. And so we now use another property. The property is that nucleons tend to have a stronger interaction if they move in opposite M states, magnetic states. The reason is they cannot move together in the same M state because they are fermions, Pauli principle. And so in order to come the closest as possible, they just take orbits with different M states. So once in this direction, once in this direction, then they will be close twice when they orbit around the inert core. So this is a pairing property, which will be discussed next week by Machiavelli. And so we can now consider that we only describe nucleon pairs. Now the question is, of course, if they are in opposite M values, they couple to zero. And the next possibility is that they couple to two. And so we can now restrict ourselves, truncate again our model space to L equals zero and L equals two pairs. And this is still a very difficult problem because these are nucleon pairs made out of fermions. And so the proposition made by Iacello and Arima is a very drastic one. Let's just replace these fermion pairs with L equals zero by an S boson, an L equals zero boson, and these L equals two pairs by a D boson. So we do a boson mapping.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
Why there are only S and D?
Because we have identical nucleons, and because of the Pauli principle, if you you need to have an anti-symmetrized wave function. And this is a very amazing thing. If you construct now fermions with spin half integer, and you impose anti-symmetrized wave functions, it turns out you cannot make an L equal one state. If you do the same with bosons, bosons have integer spin, and they have to be symmetrized, it's exactly the same. They cannot make an L equal one state. Yes. Yeah?
Yeah, I showed that in my first lecture also.
Okay, yeah.
The M scheme. I think his question was, why not L equals four?
No. We will come. In the exercise,
that's
we will introduce a G boson. You can introduce. The reason is that all even nuclei have a L equals zero ground state. And all even nuclei except four have an L equal two first excited state. And then you get a four state. And so you truncate as much as possible by taking only S bosons would not make sense because you would predict that only the ground states of even nuclei. And so you take the next, the D boson, which also has the advantage that it in some sense corresponds to a quadrupole phonon. Yeah? So that's why you do that in first instance. And it will turn out, we will show it, that you get a very simple Hamiltonian. If you include more bosons, then your Hamiltonian becomes more and more complex. And it means the number of parameters increases. And that's also something you don't like. Yeah?
Can I just make a quick comment? Remember when we looked at the delta function, residual interaction,
mm-hmm.
the lowest state, the two identical fermions was zero, and the next one was two.
And then
the
four.
Others were higher. So this is an approximation
yes.
to take those lowest energy. Couples.
Historically, the story is different. Historically, the story started with quadrupole phonons, U5, and then the S boson was introduced in order to allow to describe not only spherical nuclei, but also rotational ones. But we will come to that. So this was done by Akito Arima, Franco Iacchello, and then later more microscopically for the mapping by Takahura Otsuka and Igal Talmi in 1974 to 1979. Now, Schrödinger equation in second quantization. Fock, again, has shown that you can go from the Schrödinger equation to a new form, which is a kind of occupation number representation, which is called the second quantization, and it consists of creation and annihilation operators. And you have the matrix elements of the Schrödinger equation, the kinetic energy and the potential energy here. And so this is the most general Hamiltonian in second quantization up to second order, up to two-body interactions. Now, if you work it out in detail, then you find that if you have an SND boson system where N is a constant, yeah, so a given nucleus, you make the interpretation, bosons are coupled valence nucleons, so then if I have a given nucleus, then I have a constant number of valence nucleons, so I have a constant number of bosons. Now, if you work it out, this general representation, it turns out you get a six-parameter Hamiltonian. So six-parameter, one here, epsilon nd, one for the angular momentum, L squared, then Q squared, then coupled to 3 squared, then coupled to 4 squared, that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And in the quadrupole operator, which is the only operator where you can make a mixture of S and D bosons, S and D coupled to 2, or D and D coupled to 2, I have here the sixth parameter, which is denoted by chi. So that's amazing, because you only have six parameters, and you have the most general Hamiltonian of an SD boson system. Now, if we look a little bit more in detail, then we notice that the generators of these U6 groups, they are just the combinations of creation and annihilation operators of given values. This is a special value because of the angular momentum, so it's not an annihilation operator, but it's an annihilation operator with a phase factor and a change of m in order to conserve the angular momentum. So details, again, I cannot give here. Now, remember our funny idea about this six-dimensional vector. So you can see here, I annihilate, for instance, a D minus 2 boson, and I create an S boson or something like that. It's a bit more complicated because of angular momentum. We want this to be, to have a good angular momentum and angular momentum projection. Now, if you work out the commutator of two of these generators, it is this beast. So it's a sum over other possibilities of kappa. You have square roots, you have Clebsch-Gordan coefficients, you have 6 J symbols, you have deltas, and so on. So, but they close. I mean, any commutator of two generators produces here one other generator linear and one other generator linear. Now, can we recognize certain parts of these subalgebras in this commutator? Yes, we can. First, you have to realize that if you have only D bosons, then of course if you create and annihilate D bosons, you cannot create or annihilate S bosons. So these generators have to close also among themselves. Now, what does this mean? It means that all the L values here are 2. And if you look now here, this 6J symbol, 2, 2, 2, and this 6J symbol, 2, 2, 2, are the same. The deltas are fulfilled. The deltas are fulfilled. So I can bring out these, and both these, because they are also 2, 2. And so I obtain now a subset of generators, which are the generators only made out of D bosons, and they fulfill now a subset of commutation rules. So I can bring out this one with 2 to 2. I can bring out this one because I cannot make anything else. And I have here a phase factor, which is minus 1 k, k prime, k double prime, minus 1. So we see that not only in the matrix we have a superalgebra, but also in the commutation rules we have a superalgebra by considering only D bosons. Now there's more. Interesting is this phase factor, because if k and k prime are odd, their sum is even. And if k double prime is even, then I have here 1 minus 1, 0. So it means if I now consider only odd generators with L equal 1 and L equal 3, then I can only form these combinations without this factor multiplying with 0 if k double prime is odd. So it means that I have now a subalgebra by considering the 10 odd k generators, 3 with L equal 1 and 7 with L equal 3. And they form, in fact, this SO5 subgroup, which we saw before. And then finally, if I only consider the ones with L equal 1, these are the angular momentum generators. So they form now the subgroup with SO3. And so the associated quantum numbers are n, the number of bosons, nd, the number of d bosons, tau, which is the seniority, and the angular momentum L. So this is the easy subalgebra of the interacting boson model. There are two more, which I have no time to define them. The one is going immediately from the unitary transformations to the orthogonal transformations in 6 dimensions. So it's a reduction from U6 to SO6. It turns out you again can have this SO5 and SO3 subgroup for this chain. And finally, there is a chain going from U6 to SU3 and then immediately to SO3. To the L and then the M value. Interesting is that this chain, remember quadrupole phonons are equivalent more or less as the D bosons, they represent vibrational nuclei. This chain is what we discussed yesterday, this gamma unstable nuclei, so where the potential energy is flat in the gamma direction, and the last is the rotational nuclei. And in the original work, especially prolate rotors are represented by SU3. So historically, as I said, one started from this description of quadrupole phonons, and then one realized that if one added an S boson to it, you get this group, and then one realized and introduced this S boson in order, because one knew that then rotational nuclei could be described as a subgroup. SU3 is not a subgroup of U5. The bonus was that one realized that there is a third chain, which was not built in, but it was discovered afterwards, which is this SO6 chain, with which Rick has a lot to do. Because it turned out that actually nuclei existed, which are very well described by this Hamiltonian. As an example, 110 cadmium is a vibrational nucleus, can be described by the U5 symmetry. 156 gadolinium has a rotational, with a rotational IRAS band, a beta and a gamma band, and can be described by this SU3 symmetry of the interacting boson model. And as a bonus, SO6 symmetry was predicted, and it turned out that platinum 196 is quite well described by this gamma unstable limit of the interacting boson model. Again, using our algebraic approach, we can now add all Casimir operators of these different groups up to second order Casimir operators. And again, it turned out we have 6 of these Casimir operators, and we have 6 parameters, like we had in the most general solution. So this is something we will study, for instance, in the afternoon numerically. Now, I would like to warn you, if you mix groups of different chains, like U5, SO6, or SU3, the parameters, the quantum numbers are lost. The analytic expressions are lost. The wave functions depend on the parameters. So if you take this general Hamiltonian, it's an error many students make, and you plug in here the analytic values of these Casimir operators, you're wrong. It doesn't hold. Analytic solutions are possible if you take a dynamical symmetry. It means one of these subchains of subgroups. For instance, the U5 limit, you take Casimir first order of U5, second order of U5, then of SO5 and SO3. You plug in the eigenvalues and you have an analytic solution of your many body problem. The same holds for SU3. You see here the description is more difficult because in U5 you had 5 parameters and in SU3 you have only 2 parameters. Here, these 2. And this is the analytic expression. In SO6, you have 3 parameters because you have only quadratic Casimir operators. And this is the analytic expression. And there are also analytic expressions to relate the L values contained in the lambda mu values and the lambda mu values contained in N, the number of U6. But I don't want to give this reduction rules here. Yeah, you can take that, you can take that. I mean, we will do that in the afternoon. We will have such Hamiltonians. But you cannot apply then the analytic solutions, and you cannot apply the quantum numbers. The quantum numbers will be mixed.
But there, you just take the Casimir operators in a given chain, and then you can find.
Yeah, if you have a given chain, then you have analytic solution. I would like to make a remark on a question I think you posed yesterday concerning the Davidoff model. What sense does it make to have such a model? One of the biggest senses is that any of these limits, they have an analytic solution and they have a complete basis. If you work out the EREPs, you get a complete basis. And then if you have a complete basis, you can construct any Hamiltonian and diagonalize it in a complete basis. So this is one of the most important things of such an analytic or artificial solutions. Okay. Now, associated with the interacting boson models are shapes. And these shapes can be studied using the coherent state formalism. It's a little bit like what Mark was telling. So if I have these alpha mu's, then it turns out only the M0 and the M2 parts are important to describe this shape, and I can do that with this beta cosinus gamma and this beta sinus gamma divided by square root of 2. And now I can do a energy functional approach and calculate the energy for this Hamiltonian as a function of beta, gamma, and parameters, of course, in any point of beta and gamma, normalize it, and so I can associate with it a shape. As an example, if you have a rotor, SU3 limit, you will get a minimum in the beta non-equal to 0 at the gamma equals 0 degree side. So it's a prolate rotor, which is situated then here. If I have a gamma unstable nucleus, then of course I have flat in the gamma direction, and I get a minimum at a certain value of beta, which is shallower than the one we have here. And then if I have U5, spherical rotor, then I have a minimum at beta equals 0, no deformation, and then a kind of parabolic behavior. You can also describe prolate, oblate rotors, where the minimum would be here at gamma 60 degrees. with the SU3 bar symmetry. Okay. Now, so I will do that after the break. Yeah. Okay. Are there questions? I know it's heavy stuff, but it's important to understand the rest.